Hello again. In this session, we are about to get into the analytical aspects of SPC. We mentioned many steps by which you can develop an SPC program. We talked about quality priorities, and then we talked about the importance of testing and monitoring. And the third phase is SPC analysis. And then after that, we're talking about corrective and preventive actions, and then documentation. We are at the SPC analysis. And if you look at the entire statistical process control concept, you will see that it is based on three basic tools. The primary tool is control charts, which is the subject of this session. The second tool is what we call process capability analysis. And then the third tool is problem solving techniques. But the number one tool in an SPC program is the control chart, and that's what we will cover in this session. So let's go to the slides and take a look at the different types of control charts. There are many types of control charts, but they are divided basically by the types of variables that we have to deal with. In this regard, and this is an issue that we discussed early in the STAT sessions, there are two types of variables. There are continuous variables, and there are discrete variables. The continuous variables are variables whose sample spaces or all possible outcomes are intervaled. When we talk about diameter of some rod or some meter pipe, when we talk about people income, when we talk about students' grades, all of these are continuous variables, meaning the variable can take on any values. Variables have sample spaces or all possible outcomes that are intervals, as you can see here. On the other hand, discrete variables are what we call it attribute variables in SPC. Those are the variables whose sample spaces are sets of discrete points. These are the ones that we deal with when we have to count defects or number of failures or number of passes. They are the type of stop and go, yes or no, pass or fail type variables. Some examples would be you can look at number of defects, number of rejects, number of machine failures. All of these are called discrete variables. And the importance of this division is that we have control charts that are good for continuous variables and the others that are good for attribute or discrete variables. We will begin with control charts for continuous variables. And the most commonly used charts are the X bar R and the X bar S. Now notice that we are talking about two aspects here, or two parameters, X bar, which is the average, and the R is the range. Here we're talking about X bar, which is the average, and the S, which is the standard deviation. So what we will be looking at now is pairs of charts. If you recall what we said early, when we have a population from which we take samples, control charts are about looking at the distributions of these samples day in and day out, and we can either look at the center of this distribution, which will lead to average chart or X bar chart, as we discussed before, looking at the points in control and points out of control, or we can actually look at the ranges or the spread of these distributions. Some samples will have a wide range, others will have a narrow range, and that will lead to a chart of the range. So we're talking about pairs of a chart here, one for the average and one for variability. Using the pair of charts, we would be able to observe and examine variability as well as central tendency parameters at once. So let's start with the X-bar R chart, or the so-called Shewhart control chart. This is a mean and range. So one would expect that we would be looking at two charts simultaneously. Then we will look at another pair of a chart, which is the X bar S, which is the mean and the standard deviation, also simultaneously. So let's begin with the X bar R chart. And as you will see, the calculations involved in these charts are really simple calculations. They are calculations that we have learned about back in the descriptive statistics analysis. All what we will need is to calculate mean values, range, standard deviations for each sample that we collect. So fundamentally, we don't have anything to add when it comes to statistical calculations. It is how we put all of these calculations together to produce the control charts that we will see shortly. The X-bar chart. The output of what we're going to do now is two charts. The top chart is the average, which is the X-bar, and the bottom chart is the range, which is the R chart. And as you can see here, each of these two charts have a center line, upper control limit, and the lower control limit. And we discussed how we go about determining the control limits. We told you that it's a plus or minus 3 sigma based on the empirical formula that we discussed in previous sessions. So we will need upper and lower control limits for the X bar at a standard deviation of mean, and we will need upper and lower control chart at a standard deviation of the range, but the end result will be two charts that we will observe simultaneously. So as you go from one day to another, you'll be looking at both the range of the values of the sample and the average of the same sample. This way you get to observe central tendency measures and the variability measures at once. That is the power of control charts. Every sample will consist of a number of components of size n. And as you can see, we have to calculate the average of each sample. So what are the points plotted on the X-bar chart? These will be actually the average of each sample. If we collect a sample every day, then the average of day one and the average of day two and so on will be plotted on the chart in reference to the center line and the upper and the lower control limits. And as you can see here, the center line is the mean of the process, mu, and the upper and lower control limit at a plus or minus 3 sigma. Notice what sigma here we're talking about. This is sigma over the square root of n, which we described early as the standard error or the standard deviation of means. The reason for that is we are plotting a chart of means. So we are no longer dealing with individual components, we're dealing with average values. As a result, the center line would be the average of averages, or all the mean values. And the upper and lower control limit will deviate from the center by plus or minus 3 standard deviation of averages, or sigma over the square root of n. Please go back to how we constructed confidence interval to understand what we are saying here. The good news is we will make simple estimates. For example, if you don't know sigma and you know the range, then all what you have to do is to divide the range by some constant, and that will give you the standard deviation. So that will make our life much easier, as we will see shortly. The average the entire process, or the center line, is obviously the average of all averages. That's the sum of X bars, as you can see here, divided by K, or the number of days or the number of samples that you are using. On the other hand, if we can replace sigma by R dash over D2, or that constant, then we will have simpler formula, as we will see in a minute. So let's look at the control parameters of X bar chart first. Here is what we said. We have a center line that's mu. We have an upper and lower control limit at a distance of 3 times R, dash, or the average of the average of the ranges, divided by a constant time, the square root of n. Notice that the square root of the sample size determine how far the upper or lower control limit will be from the center line. For the x bar chart, we can take all of this and simplify it further by calling it A2 times R bar. So if we take 3 divided by D2 times the square root of n, this we would be called A2 times R bar. And as you can see here, here is the center line X double bar or mu. Here is the upper control limit, which is the overall average plus the constant A2 times the average range. Here is the lower control limit, which is the overall average minus the constant A2 times the average range. We'll see this by calculations in a minute. Very good. For the range, we have the center line of the chart would be the average of all ranges, as we will see by example. The upper and lower control limits will be deviating from the center by plus or minus 3 sigma of the range. Because as I said, sigma is always defined in reference to what parameters we are monitoring. And in this case, we're going to make it very simple for you. All what you have to do is use a constant D4 times the average range, and that will give you the upper control limit, and a constant D3 times the range, average range, and that will give you the lower control limit. So the calculations, as you would see, have actually been made have been made more simple than we anticipate. So here are the control limits for the R chart. R average or R bar is the center line. D4 R bar is the upper control limit. D3 R bar is the lower control limit. Let's take an example and we will see. But before we take an example, let's just review these. Here is the X bar chart. Underneath it, which will always be placed, the range chart or the R chart. The center line here is X double bar or the overall average. The center line in the bottom chart is the average range. The upper and lower control limits in each chart is determined by the average range and some constant A2, D3, D4, which we can obtain from tables that will determine this constant depending on the sample size we'll use. As you can see here, here is the subgroup size or the sample size. And of course, the minimum sample size in a control chart will be 2, right? Because 1 is just an individual. And then it can be 3, 4, 5, all the way to normally 25 is about the maximum number of individuals that we use in a subgroup or a sample for control charts. But at each sample size, you have the constant A2, as you can see. You have the constant D3 and the constant D4. These are the three constants that we need to actually be able to determine the control limits of the X bar R chart. Okay? Very good. Let's take an example now. The data below represents values of some fiber diameter or rod diameter or metal diameter. It really doesn't matter at this point because you can use this chart for any continuous variable. And what we have here is days, day January 1 and January 1 again, January 1. The reason we have the day replicated is because we have three shifts, shift 1, shift 2, shift 3 within day 1. And then we have three shifts in day 2 and so on. So basically, we are really looking at data on shift to shift basis here. These are working shifts that are typically maybe 8 hours in some factories or maybe 10 hours in other factories. And every day, we are taking a sample of size 4. You can see here 1, 2, 3, 4. And we are testing the diameter. So every day, or sorry, every shift, we are taking a sample of size 4, and we are measuring the diameter of each component of the sample. And as you can see here, we have every shift, and in every shift we have 4, and we repeat this on daily basis. That is typically what happened in a factory or any organization. They collect the data of samples on daily basis to be monitored. So what's the first step to construct a control chart? The first step will be to calculate the overall average, first the average of each sample and the range of each sample. So as you can see here, for sample of shift one, this is the average 12.242. That's the average of these four observations. And this is the range of these four observations. And we repeat these calculations for every day. So we're no longer going to be dealing with individual values now. Instead, we're going to be dealing with the average of each sample and the range of each sample, as you can see. If we want to construct a control chart, all what we have to do is to actually calculate the overall average of averages and their average of ranges. As you can see here, this is X double bar, which is the first average, 12.242, plus the second average, all the way to the last average, 12.042, divided by 19, because we have used 19 shifts to calculate the overall average of the X-bar chart of this process. For the ranges, we calculate the range of every day, and then we calculate the overall average of the ranges. As you can see here, R-bar, which is the average range. That's the first range, plus the second range, third range, all the way to the final range, divided by 19. So we now have the overall average of averages and the overall average of ranges, and this will represent the first one will represent the average of the X-bar chart or the center line of the X-bar chart, and the second one will represent the center line of the R chart. So we really have our center lines set now of the two charts, X double bar and the R bar. So we have this one and we have this one. Okay, so what do we need now? We need the upper and lower control limit for each chart. Now notice the formula here. These are very simple formula. All what we need now for the upper control limit in the X bar chart is to know X double bar, which we already calculated, the 11.95. Then we need the average range, which we already calculated, 1.08. So what's missing here is the simple constant A2, which will depend, as we mentioned, on the sample size. Same thing here. We have the center line R bar, and we have the upper control limit, which is a constant D4 times the average range. We have all of this. And the lower control limit is the D3 times the average range. So if we can find the A2, D3, D4, then we actually determined all the control limits that we need. At this point, we found the average of the X-bar chart or the center line of the X-bar chart and the center line of the range chart. Okay, now we are trying to get the constants, A2, D4, and D3. If you recall, we have a table for that. And this table will give us these values in accordance to the sample size. Since the sample size is 4, recall that we have actually 4 samples, 4 individuals in each sample. So the sample size is 4. This will give us from the table the value of A2 and the value of D3 and the value of D4. And if we have these values, then it's a straightforward calculation to calculate the upper control limit and the lower control limit. You can see here X double bar is 11.958 and the A2 coming from this table is 0.729 times the average range, which we calculated a minute ago as 108. So using that, that will give us the upper control limit. And really, this is X bar plus this term, X bar minus this term will give us the lower control limit. Now, for the range chart, we have the overall average range, which is 1.08, and the upper and lower control limits are determined by the average range as well as these two constants. Notice that D3 is 0, giving us a lower control limit of 0 or the baseline of the graph. Now that we obtain the upper and lower control limits for each chart, we can then plot the chart. As you can see here, this is the center line, which is the 11.958. This is the upper control limit, 12.745. This is the lower control limit. All of this for the top chart or the X-bar chart. We also have the same thing for the bottom chart or the R chart. It's very important to understand that these two charts have to be arranged the same way that you see in this slide here, where the X-bar in the top and the R chart in the bottom, and the everyday correspondence of the range and the average you can actually see. Okay, And once we establish these control charts, then we can use it to monitor future values of the process. We can use this forever as long as the process has not changed. So it's very important that we look at the correspondence, and we can then, if we trust the chart, we can move on by monitoring further points, shift 22, shift 23, and so on. And we can look at points that are in control versus points that are out of control. And as we mentioned before, points that are in control require no action, and points out of control are in a state of out of control, and they require actions. So it's very important that we establish the chart first before we can actually use it to monitor future values. It's also very important, as you interpret the charts, is to notice what we said early. We said that there are criteria to observe and evaluate a chart. One is whether the points are in control or out of control. Points are that are in control or within the control limits require no action. Points that are outside the control limits require some actions. We need to investigate why these points went out of control. The other issue is the pattern, whether the chart exhibits some pattern, such as a run where all the points are above the center line or below the center line, a trend in the chart, a periodic or cyclical type pattern. All of these we have to watch carefully when we are observing control charts. It's very important from the slides here that we look at the R chart first. Always look at the variability chart, then look at the center line, because mean values, or the average chart, I mean, because mean values can obviously be misleading sometimes. A mean value can mask the lows and the highs. So you want to look at the R chart first, and after you observe a point in the R chart, you look at the corresponding average, because our concern is really the variability within each sample. The next type of chart is the X bar S. This is if you don't want to use the range, you can use the standard deviation. That's another variability measure, as we discussed early on in statistics. And one can expect now that we're going to have an X bar chart on the top and the standard deviation in the bottom instead of the range chart. The steps are very systematic, and they are almost the same as we did with the R chart, except we're going to use different constants, as you will see here on the slides. The X bar S chart. Here is the X bar chart, and as you can see here, the center line again is X double bar. The upper and lower control limits are X double bar plus or minus a constant time the average standard deviation. The bottom chart, which is the standard deviation chart, again, the center line will be the average standard deviation, and the upper and lower control limits will be constants times the average standard deviation. So again, we need to find the values of A3 and B4 and B3, and these again come from tables readily available for you to use depending on the sample size. So here is the same example we had a minute ago. Now this time we're going to go for each shift and calculate the X bar, the average, and calculate the standard deviation. Remember, in the last example or the previous example, we calculated the average of each sample and the range. This time we will calculate the average of each sample and the standard deviation. That is the X bar S. And we do that for every shift. And at the very end, we calculate the overall average of all the mean values, which is, as you can see, 12.24 plus 11.881 all the way to 12.042 divided by 19, as we did before. Then we take the standard deviations and also calculate the average of a standard deviation, 0.377 plus 0.493 and so on all the way to 0.328. So that's all the standard deviation, the sum of the standard deviation divided by the number of samples or the number of days that we have used the calculation for. So we have the center line of the X bar chart, and we have the center line of the S chart. These are these two values here. And then we need the upper and lower control limit, which means we need A3 For the X bar chart at 4 is 1.628, as you can see here. So X double bar is 11.95 plus the 1.628, the constant time, the S bar that we just calculated, that give us the upper control limit. The lower control limit, same calculation, but this plus will be minus. And as you can see here, it's 11.155. For the S chart, same thing. The upper control, we know the center line, which is the average standard deviation. Upper and lower control limit will depend on the average standard deviation and the constant which we get from this table, B30 at N equal 4, B4 is 2266 at N equal 4. So now we have everything that we need. We can plot the X bar chart with the upper and lower control limit and the center line. We can plot the S chart with the upper and lower control limit and center line. And again, we can use these charts in correspondence. So you look at, as I always say, look at the variability first, look at the standard deviation first, and then after that, look at the average of each day. Okay, you start here and then you go up. And once you trust the charts, then you can actually use it to monitor future values to see if the points of average and the points of standard deviation will be out or in control so that we can take corrective actions. What we discussed here is very simple. The calculations steps are actually very simple because we covered that before. We covered how to calculate standard deviation and how we calculate a range and how we calculate a mean value. So given these three and the sample size, you can see that constructing an X bar R or an X bar S charts is basically a systematic steps that anyone can do in a very simple, in a very short period of time. And the merits of these charts, as we discussed early, is tremendous because once you construct a chart, you can then monitor future points on the chart to see if indeed your process is in control or out of control.